Man, that's what it's all about. Today, I want to invite you to reach and grab your Bibles. Turn back to James chapter 1. James chapter 1, Will Rogers one time, in so many witty ways that he can speak, he said, the road to success is dotted with many tempting parking spaces. The road to success is dotted with many tempting parking spaces. The idea is, as we're on our journey through life, we're always tempted to pull over and stop and not ultimately get where we want to go, or more specifically for us today, where God wants us to go. And really, those parking spaces, as it relates to what we're going to talk about today, are the ideas of temptations in our life. Things that distract us or keep us from being all that God wants us to be. Last week, we started studying the book of James. James was written by the brother of Jesus. Right before he was martyred, he was wanting to speak to people, God's children, who were there scattered. They were being persecuted. And he wrote this book. If I were to take the book of James and if I were to write it today, or we were to write it today and bind it in a softback edition or a hardback edition, and we were to put it in a bookstore, in a library somewhere, it would probably go in the how-to section. How to be a better Christian, how to be a better believer, how to live life in such a way that we glorify God. Last week, if you remember, James, after introducing himself and telling who he was writing to, he jumped right into a major issue. For the early church and the early believers, trials were difficulties that they faced each and every day. Hardships. As a matter of fact, James was martyred, as I just said, many of the early church. They were persecuted for their beliefs. They were mocked. They would lose their jobs. All of those things took place. Those were trials, and James talked to us last week about how we deal with trials in our life. And we said every one of us faces them. Today, he changes just a bit, and he talks to us about how to deal with temptations in our lives. Just like trials, everybody deals with them. Temptations are the same way. Everybody in this room deals with some sort of temptation, some sort of struggle. What does it mean? What's the definition of temptation? Let's put it up on the screen for you. A temptation simply means, as we say it today, means to allure, attract, seduce, or entice. To lure, attract, seduce, or entice. Now, I want you to know, as we read through James chapter 1, we have many, many more words in the English language than they did in the Greek language. The same Greek word that was used up in verse 2 and all the way from verse 2 to verse 11 for trials is the same Greek word that is used by James here, picking up in verse 13 to talk about temptations. Now, then how do we know the difference? Well, context determines so much for the Greeks in the way they wrote and the way they talked. Context was everything. And this word, this Greek word that could mean trial in some instance, but it also could be temptation. The temptation to pull off the road to success and into an empty parking space that will ultimately harm us and keep us from getting where God wants us to go. So I want you to know, the same Greek word that means trials is also the same Greek word that means temptation. It's the context of the verses and the context of the settings that makes it clear to us which one of the translations or which one of the definitions of that word truly James means in this instance. So let's put, as I bring you a message today entitled, The Anatomy of Temptation and How to Deal with It. Y'all know what anatomy is. It is that branch of biology that studies the structures of human and living organisms. I've told you before, I've shared this story before. At the latter days of my years at Baylor, I had an elective to take, and I always liked sports, and I like different things, and so I thought it would be a wise thing to do for an elective to take an anatomy and physiology class. And then I realized, there are a bunch of doctors and nurses in this class. And so I just hung on by the hair of my chinny chin chin. I mean, I just survived the class. Did not take anatomy and physiology too. Was not invited to take it either. But Annette, I loved it. I loved it. I loved the learning. I loved soaking up structures and everything. The problem was then they wanted you to answer questions on a test. And I struggled with that. And so today I want to break out the anatomy of temptation for you, but more importantly, and see how James and others in the New Testament says we have to deal with them. In James chapter 1, let's pick it up reading in verse 13. James said, "When tempted, no one should say, 'God has tempted me.' For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone." Now, in verses 13 to 18, I want you to notice here as we read through, James gives us a negative and a positive. The first negative thing is right here. He says, listen, don't let anybody say, if you are tempted, that God is tempting you. God may allow you to go through temptation. God may allow you to go through trials, but God's not the one that's bringing them. So it says, God, don't let anyone say negatively, don't ever say God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone to do evil or to sin. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away. Here's the anatomy, all right? You ready? The structure, the anatomy. We're going to look at this in a few seconds. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, what happens when we're dragged away? Then after desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Now, if we let temptation go unchecked in the early stages, it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger and worse and worse and worse, and the consequences get bigger and bigger and bigger and worse and worse and worse. That's why we want to look at it, we want to identify it, we want to see it, and then we want to say, how do I stay out of that parking space that is dotted with my sin? I will tell you, as we're all journeying down the road, the road to being what God wants us to be, there are parking spaces for each of us. And there are signs in those parking spaces. And a lot of times in those parking spaces, there is a sign that says, John Mark's favorite sin. Or the one he succumbs to often. It's usually got a bluebell emblem right under it or something. But see, your sign is different. There are, sometimes I drive past your empty parking space that has your name and your sin, and I think, how could anybody be drawn into that parking space? And a little further down, I go, here's mine. And James is saying, listen, we have to be careful, because what happens is when my temptation goes unchecked, it will move towards a sin, which will lead to another sin, which will lead to another sin. So let's read on. It says, then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Now let me tell you, note to self, you might want to write this down. When Satan shows up and tempts you, he never talks about death. He never says, if you do this, by the way, it'll destroy your family. At the bottom of this bottle might be your job and career. At the bottom of this might be that. But we have to understand that as it begins to grow, that's exactly what happened. He says, don't be deceived, my brothers and sisters. Every good, here's the positive. God doesn't tempt us to sin, but God does give us good and perfect gifts from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose, listen to this, to give us birth, not to sin, through the word of truth, that we might, listen, be a kind of first fruits of all he created. In other words, God does not tempt us to sin, but what he does, he gives us the opportunity, the good gifts, that perhaps through his spirit and through his word and through the way we live, that we would be more and more on a daily basis like Adam and Eve was supposed to be. But what happens when we are tempted? Let's talk a little bit about temptation. What happens when we are tempted and ultimately sin? What do? We normally have one of two common responses, don't we? We normally have one of two common responses. Write that down. James gives us a couple right here. Let's go back to our passage, James chapter 1, verse 13. Two common responses to sin. James 1, verse 13 says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. The first thing we do when we sin, oftentimes, is we blame someone else, right? We blame others. Write that down. That's our common response. If you say, no, I really don't do that, Pastor. Anybody have kids? You ever walked in on your kids and they both have their hands around the other one's throat? And they've thrown stuff around and they've broken, and you grab your son, you look at your son, and you go, what did you do? What is his immediate response? Well, she... And have you ever done this with your kids? Read my lips. I didn't ask you what your sister did. What did you do? But she, and they keep going on and on, right? And then you go ask she, and she says, but he. That's what we normally do. We have a tendency, what? To blame others. Newsflash. This is nothing new when it comes to sin. We always blame others. Go all the way back to the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 3. Let's put it up there. Genesis chapter 3. What do we see? This is Adam and Eve. Remember, God created the Garden of Eden, put Adam and Eve in sinless perfection there, set them out in the garden, said, listen, y'all can do anything you want to in this garden. Enjoy the garden. Till it be fruitful and multiply. Do all of those things. But the one thing I don't want you to do is to eat of that tree. Right? Don't eat of that tree. Then God comes down to walk in the cool of the night. What was their immediate response after, listen to this, after they had sinned? They went and hid. And now let me just tell you right now, and I want you to hear me, and I want to just share this. A lot of times when we sin, our first natural recourse is to withdraw from God's presence and God's people. And I want you to know, if you're struggling with sin, don't let that be you. Don't let that be you. And that's exactly what we see. They went off and hid, so God had to say, God called to the man, says, where are you? Now, God said, once he said, did you eat of the tree? That's what's in the dot, dot, dot. You can go read it for Genesis chapter 3 yourself. And remember the man, look at how Adam, he mans up right here. He immediately blames Eve. The man said, the woman, now it's interesting, he's not really just blaming the woman. He's also blaming God, right? He says, the woman who I didn't ask for. I mean, it was just cool when it was me and you, right? He goes, it wasn't like I said, hey, can you send a woman? He goes, you're God, right? He says, the woman that you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree to eat. And so the Lord goes and talks to the woman, and she doesn't man up either, all right? The woman said, God said to the woman, what is this that you've done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. Our first and natural recourse when we don't resist temptation and we fall to sin is to blame someone else. Another temptation is we oftentimes just simply want to blame God. You know, God, you made me this way. You put me this way. You know, this is just who I am, and I can't struggle. I struggle with this, but God, this is kind of your fault. Solomon in Proverbs chapter 19 put it this way. Look at what he says. He says, a man's own folly is what ruins his life. What ruins our life? Our own folly. Yet his heart rages against the Lord. You say, Pastor, no one would do that. Happens all the time. Happens all the time. A man or a woman rushes headlong into an inappropriate relationship or follow an addiction or follow a struggle. You know what an addiction is, right? It's just a temptation we can no longer control. It now controls us. That's the only difference between a temptation and an addiction. Temptation is just, boy, it entices us, it lures us in. An addiction is when that temptation controls me and I don't control it. But what do? We blame God. And so that's what we see here. He says, a man's own folly. Man, how many times we say, you know what? I know I made a mistake, but I prayed that God would fix it. And how could God let this happen to me? How could God let this happen to me? And yet his heart rages against the Lord. How many times I've talked to people and hurt for people and prayed with people who say, you know, I've just been mad at God for a long, long time. I've been mad at God for a long, long time because I lost my family or I lost this. And you begin to talk to them, and pretty much it was a lot of their own doing. It was a lot of their own struggle. It was a lot of their own sin, a lot of their own decisions. But they're mad at God. And what have they done? They've done exactly what Adam and Eve did. They retreated from God instead of running to God. They retreated from God. And so it's just, yet his heart rages against the Lord. Well, let's get into that anatomy part of it. What is the structure and perhaps even what is the source of our temptation? James gives us some help. He tells us and talks about the structure and the source of our temptation. Let's put it up on the screen. Picked it up in verse 14. Let's put it up there. It says, but each person, all right, each person, let me just stop you right here. If you are a living, breathing, walking, visual, talking person, you have the ability to be tempted. There is no one in here that is above temptation. As a matter of fact, this day in history, April the 10th, 1912, would not have been a good day to be on the biggest and most powerful and safest ocean liner ever to depart the dock. The Titanic this day left. With all the pageantry and all the beauty and all the singing and all the people and all the celebration, and 4 days later, we all know what happened. There might be some in here today that you think, you know, there are probably some people in here that need a good solid message on temptation. Be careful. 4 days, 4 hours, 4 minutes, be careful. He says, but each person is tempted. Every one of us is tempted. Now, you're probably tempted in different ways than me. Like I told you, empty parking spots along the road, some don't entice me, some don't allure me, some don't do any of those, but they are yours. He says, each person is tempted. There's that word. When they are dragged away by their own evil desire, there are certain things that I crave in my heart and are enticed by. Then after desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. There's the structure, all right, in the anatomy of it. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Now, let me give you a couple of thoughts about the structure and the source of temptation. Structure thought number one is this. Temptation is common to each and every one of us. We just saw that. Temptation is common to each and every one of us. Every one of us is tempted by something. What did Paul say in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13? Look at what Paul said. He said, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to man. Now, I want you to know this. Usually, I think back in my past when I've succumbed to temptation, I like to think that my temptation was pretty extraordinary, right? It wasn't. It was just a temptation each and every one of us for. Everyone in here is prone to certain temptation, and they're common to all of us. Temptation is common to all. It's common to mankind. Listen to this, but God is faithful. Remember, God doesn't tempt us, but God gives us positively good gifts. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will provide a way out so that you can endure it. What does God do? God provides a way out of temptation. That's His good gift. Remember, good gifts from the Father of lights above? Man, that's what He wants us to do. God says, here's the path out. What's the deciding factor? Am I willing to take it? Am I willing to take it? Man, temptation and sin is common to all of us. Read a journal article this week from the Harvard Medical Society, and it was really their letter on mental health, and it was talking about, they estimate that there are about 23 million Americans that are struggling with an addiction of something, of some sort right now. It's either alcohol or it's drugs. One of those, it really is. It's alcohol. Two-thirds of those who are struggling with addiction, whether it's just alcohol or something else, also have a tendency, two-thirds of that 23 million also have a tendency to abuse alcohol. What they found, that there are patterns that develop neurologically and physiologically in our lives that make the draw towards the temptation that has now become an addiction harder and harder and harder to resist. Why? As they've studied, that your body has a neurological response and a physiological response to whatever your temptation is. They also found, listen to this, the exact same physiological and neurological response happens in our bodies, the exact same response for anything that brings us pleasure. The exact same response comes from food we enjoy, alcohol, drugs, a sexual encounter, an erotic image, monetary rewards. It's the exact same physiological response. All right? The same neurons, the same dopamine, the same everything. It always happens. Now listen, here's the problem. Once we have, listen to this, once we have gone so far with whatever we are struggling with, that dopamine and that response no longer gives us a high. What happens? Then we have to ingest more, we have to consume more, we have to take more, right? Man, that's what they said. And 23 million Americans struggle with this. Now, here's the key. It's not just alcohol and drugs. We could be addicted to food. We could be addicted to rage. We could be addicted to pornography, alcohol, cocaine, whatever it is. It is the same addiction process. Exact same addiction process. And so notice what he says. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, and God is faithful. He will provide a way out. So listen, thought number one on the structure of temptation, it's common to all of us, but it also comes from inside of us. Write that down. It comes from inside of us. Remember what James said? We are each tempted from our own evil desires. Let me just give you kind of four C's that hopefully will explain this process of temptation. Are you ready? It starts with some sort of craving. It starts with some sort of craving. And then what? We begin to, after we crave it, we desire it, we long for it. And then what happens? Man, we begin to create, we begin to think, we begin to conceive. What would it be like? Or we begin to conceive, what was it like? And then we what? We begin to create a path to get there. In that study I referenced a few minutes ago, they use that age-old analogy. They use the same one about how our body responds physically to some sort of temptation and sin and addiction. You've heard the story about when one hiker walks through the woods, and as they walk through the woods, they lay down a little grass, and it makes it easier and easier for the next hiker to go through, and eventually you have a path that is drawn through. They say that's exactly what happens physiologically in our body, is that we begin to develop a path and a path and a path and a path where neurologically, physiologically, we're drawn back to that. So if you've ever wondered, listen, and I want you to know, let's be honest. The reason why Harvard and so many other researchers are doing this study, not because they're good Christians. It's because they want to, in a non-Christian manner, explain all of our diseases and what absolve everybody from personal responsibility. As believers, we understand that God is the one who wants to absolve us of our personal responsibility. That's called a good gift of forgiveness that God gives us. Now, But we need to understand as God's children that we are all prone to repeating the same pattern of sin after sin. Even good people who love God fall to temptation and sin over and over and over again. And I think far too often when this takes place, the church, when someone sins, the church has a tendency to back away and withdraw. And that is absolutely the wrong thing to do. Because then what happens? That body, that physiological response longs for something else. What should the church do? When someone struggles, we should go in. We should be there. When someone who, that same study said of those 23 million people, of those who go through some sort of addiction rehab, about 40 to 60%, somewhere they said between 40 and 60% have a relapse. Between 40 and 60, and there are people who I know in our church that they've been through drug and they've been through alcohol or they've been through some other temptation or they've done this and that, what happened? And they relapse. Doesn't mean they weren't trying. Doesn't mean they don't love God. Just means they blew it and they failed and they struggled. And once a temptation has become addiction, it controls you. You don't control it. That's why we as a ministry a number of years ago, we as a church a number of years ago, started a ministry that meets on Monday nights called Celebrate Recovery, to really help people process that through. And as we get the junk out, you got to put God back in. So notice it says we crave something and we conceive of it and we create and then we consent. Boy, you crave something. You say, what does this mean? Anybody besides me, this is my deal. And I sit there. You ever just been sitting there? You're just minding your own business. You're watching the Rangers or something like that. And all of a sudden you're sitting there going, I'd love some cookies and cream ice cream. Right? I mean, you're just sitting there going, man, I'd love. And then you kind of start saying, well, what would it take for me to get some cookies and cream ice cream? And I think, hey, there's not any in the freezer. Then I think, darn those kids. Whose kids are they? And I'm like, well, if I waited in between innings and I pushed pause, I could make it to Kroger and back and probably wouldn't miss that much. So how long would it take? And then we begin to create a plan. All right, let me just stand there until this at bat's over with my keys in my hand, and then all of a sudden we consent. You know, it's one thing for us to sit here, and it's real innocuous when we talk about ice cream. But what if your addiction's pornography? What if your addiction is alcohol? And you've been through rehab, and you're a man in here or a woman in here, and you don't want to let your husband or your wife down. So what do? You crave. Then you conceive. You know, what I could do is I could put vodka in a bottle and just kind of keep it in my vehicle. If I use Sprite, it won't be noticed, and I won't smell it that much. What are we doing? We're conceiving and we're creating and we're consenting. Here's the next thought on temptation. Is temptations, all of them come from Satan, folks. Remember James told you earlier, he says, hey, don't blame God. All temptation comes from Satan. Can I just tell you, temptation came from Satan in Genesis and the Garden of Eden. When Jesus was walking the earth, temptation came from Satan. Remember Matthew chapter 4 when Jesus was tempted? Let's put it up on the screen here. Matthew chapter 4, it says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by who? 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 Are y'all awake? Hopefully y'all hadn't drifted off and y'all aren't thinking about your favorite temptation, all right? What would it be like? That's not the point of the message, okay? The point is to help you deal with it, all right? Satan, and let me tell you what, Satan knows your number, all right? I wish there are times that I'll start all of a sudden about like you, and that usually means my kids, we've gone to the Rangers game or something, they filled out these cards so they can guess the number of balls so somehow we can win a trip to Hawaii, which I never win. The only thing I seem to win are a bunch of phone calls, right? And so all of a sudden you get enough of them, you go on there and you get a no-call list. I wish God would create a no-tempt list. Wouldn't that be awesome? That's called heaven. By the way, you got to have to leave. You kind of have to leave here, right? Because Satan, this is his territory. It says, man, we are tempted by the devil after, he was tempted by the devil after 40 days and 40 nights. He was hungry. What was it? That was a natural urge. Listen, he was hungry. How many of you get hungry? How many of you have already noted it's afternoon today, right? You've already noted, right? You should go to Life Group. They have donuts there. If you came hungry, that's your fault. It says, after fasting for 40 days, he was hungry. A physical need, everything. So many of our temptations is just because of physical need. We want to be happy. We want to be well fed. We want this. We want some intimate pleasure. We want this. We just have a need. Jesus had a need. He was hungry. So the tempter, Satan, came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, gave him the word of God. It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Man, every time he was tempted, he responded with God's word. Every time he tempted, he responded with God's word, but he also responded with obedience. I'm not going to go there, but Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, I put it there. I want you to read it. Here's what it says. We do not have a high priest who cannot identify with our weaknesses. For Jesus has been tempted in every way as we were, yet he did not sin. Jesus showed us the way. Jesus showed us the way. Respond with God's word and respond with obedience. Let me give you two distinctly different paths from the Old Testament. You'll remember both of these guys. You remember the first guy? We find him in Genesis chapter 39. Two distinctly different paths in handling our temptation. The first one was a guy named Joseph. Remember, Joseph was sold into slavery? And we'll put it up there on the screen. Go ahead. Two distinctly different paths. Joseph was sold into slavery. Man, did everything right. Found himself in Potiphar's house. When he was in Potiphar's house, Potiphar's wife wanted to pull him into bed. All the servants were gone. It was just Joseph and the wife. And what does it say? As you look all the way down, what are the last five words there that are underlined? He did what? Ran out of the house. All right? Now, there was another guy. How many of you would agree Joseph is pretty godly? If you read the whole story of Joseph, there's not one bad thing said about Joseph. There was another guy, and we find him in 2 Samuel chapter 11. Remember the sweet little boy that was anointed king over Israel, the most unlikely king, and remember that little sling and the rock and David and golly, all the good stuff. As a matter of fact, y'all finish the story. We are told that David was a man. So David loved God, but still had 2 Samuel chapter 11. Remember the story? Go to David now, 2 Samuel chapter 11. It says, one evening David got up from his bed and walked around the top of the roof of the palace. From the roof he saw a woman bathing. There ain't a man in this room that wouldn't take notice. If you've got red blood flowing through your veins, you're going to take notice. Then it was worse. She was beautiful. Doesn't say she was ugly. And David sent someone to find out about her. And the man said, she is Bathsheba. Let me tell you what. After he had seen her bathing, after he had noticed she was beautiful, and after he found out her name, David didn't hear anything else, because none of it mattered. He had a craving he had created. He was about to consent. It says, she is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Then David sent messengers to get her. Now, I don't know how much he heard Uriah the Hittite. Oh, she must be lonely. She must be gone. I don't know what David's motives were. David's motives might have been somewhat pure. Hey, I know her husband's gone or whatever, but clearly the end of the story is this. He went and got her. Remember the four C's? She came to him and he slept with her. One ran out of the house. One messed up royal. We all want to be Joseph. And by the way, I'm not just talking about adultery here. That happens to be the example. We all want to be Joseph. If your struggle is alcohol, your heartbeat is to run from it, but you're not always successful. You know, in that Harvard study, the number one thing people are addicted to when it comes to drugs, everybody says it's not addicting, but it seems like no one can get off, is marijuana. You want to know what number two is? Narcotic pain prescriptions. There are probably a bunch of people here that struggle with that. You may have a back injury or this or that, and that's your issue. You want to be Joseph. I want to kick it. I want to get rid of it. I want to go away, but I can't. I struggle. Some people here, it's pornography. Some people here, let's be honest, you talk down everybody else, but your addiction is food. And that's a sin. Everybody struggles with something. We all blow it. So is there a cure, Pastor? Absolutely. You ready? The cure for our failure is this. Number one, we have to own it. Number two, we have to confess it. Number three, we have to work to do everything we can to prevent it. Write that down. We have to work to prevent it. Man, we have to work to prevent it. Let's talk about, first of all, about owning it. Look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. It says, if we confess our sins. I'm pretty good. It doesn't hurt me a lot to point out your sins. Matter of fact, I kind of enjoy them from time to time, especially when I get a chance. Did you hear what old so-and-so did? If we confess our sins, He, God, capital H, is faithful and just to what? Forgive us our sins. God negatively doesn't tempt us, but He does good, positively give us good gifts. Forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness if we own it. That word, confess, means to agree with God. That means I stop justifying, I stop blaming, but she, but he, but this, but that. I say guilty as charged. I am the man. I did it. I own it. I confess it. I agree with God. I get down on my hands and knees. I say, God, I can't deal with it. I can't justify it. I can't blame my drinking on my wife or my wife on my drinking. That's kind of funny if you listen to it both ways. I have to own it. Then I have to confess it. Confess, agree with God. Then we have to prevent it. Look at Psalm 11, verse 9. Let's start talking about preventing it. You ready? I know we're a little long here, but I want you to hear this. Because I think far, far, far too often, too many in the church think I'm okay, you're okay, when we're not okay. And too many people, listen to this, too many people walk in here and you look around and you think you're the only one struggling with pornography or my husband's the only one that cheated on me, or my wife's the only one that cheated on me, or I'm the only one that has this, or I'm the only one that gambles, or I'm the only one. There's a Bible word called bull, from the Greek word bulamos. There are a lot of people struggling. There are a lot of people in here in church that they look down their snouts at everyone else, and your sin is judging, and you just beat a path right down there every day. You love nothing more than for someone to submit a prayer request of something they know that someone is struggling with, so you can burn up the phone lines to gossip and slander about them. And that is not the way God's people should operate. Psalm 119, the psalmist says, how can a young man stay on the path of purity? By what? By living according to your word. There it is. That's the obedience aspect. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. Man, listen to this, verse 11. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. That word might, man, I'm going to invest my life. I'm going to pour my life. How do you hide your heart and God's word in your heart? By coming to church, by studying your Bible. This week, you see it there on the bottom of your note. Every day I'm going to do a devotion on temptation and dealing with temptation, man. But notice it says Hebrews chapter 10. What does it say in Hebrews chapter 10? You can go read it. He says, do not forsake assembling of yourselves together, gathering together as some are in the habit of doing. But we want to encourage you all the more to gather together so that we can spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Let me tell you what, if you're struggling with alcohol, if you're struggling with another addiction, the first thing Satan wants you to do is withdraw from the church and God's people. And I will tell you, if you remove the good influences in your life, it will only go downhill from there. Beyond that, church, the thing that Satan wants us to do when we hear of someone else falling back into sin or falling into sin, Satan wants us to withdraw from them. What do we expect? Man, let me tell you what. When someone falls down, the church needs to rush in to lift them up, to encourage them, to draw them to a Father. Let me give you a closing prayer. And obviously in Psalm 51, this prayer that David is praying is one after Bathsheba, but I want you to hear me. If you are struggling with a secret sin, or perhaps it's not a secret, your wife knows about it, or your husband knows about it, or somebody else knows about it, this can be your prayer. Don't think, well, you know what? If I ever have a Bathsheba in my life, I'll pray this prayer. Let me tell you what, if you've got sin in your life, you need to pray this prayer. We need to pray this prayer. Look at Psalm 51. This is David. Now, remember what happened? The preacher, the church went in and came to David when everybody else thought they couldn't approach the king. Man, Nathan the prophet went in and said, David, hey, buddy, you've been called. And he says, have mercy on me, O God. This is David's prayer after he finally owned it. Now he's confessing, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. See, God doesn't tempt us, but he does give us good gifts. And one of the first good gifts he'll give you when you're honest with about your sin is he will give you his unfailing love. According to your great compassion, he says, blot out whose transgressions? Man, a lot of times we get so spiritually superior, we pray for a lot of other people's sins. But he says, my transgressions. He says, wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Notice, my transgressions, my iniquity, my sin. He's owning it. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, he says, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are right when you're right in your verdict, and when you judge You are justified. You're justified when you judge. He says, cleanse me with the hyssop. I shared with this. You see the hyssop. You saw it back in the Passover when the blood of the lamb was put over the door frame of the house. The hyssop was there at the crucifixion of Christ as pointing to forgiveness. Now he says, cleanse me with the hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all of my iniquity. Look at verse 10. Then he says, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew in me a steadfast spirit. Let me tell you why. Why did he pray verse 10? Because let me tell you what, if you're going to resist temptation and if you're going to flee from sin, you are going to have a steadfast spirit. It's hard. And if there are those here, you're struggling with a son or a daughter or a husband or a maid who's struggling with an addiction, don't let them withdraw. Don't let the church withdraw from them. Let the Spirit of God and the grace of God and the good gifts of God, along with their steadfast spirit, pursue God. Pursue God. I want to invite Keith to come out. And Keith, as he's making his way out, we're going to finish by singing How Great Is Our God. And when we sing, our altar team's going to be here. I told you, if you're struggling with an addiction on Monday nights, we have a ministry called Celebrate Recovery here. And I want our altar team to go ahead and come down front during this song. And if you're here and you need to pray with somebody about something going on in your life, make your way here. As I say every week, please, please, please don't head to the door if you need to head to the altar.